I'm good. Chad got it. Thank you, Jake. Everyone, thank you for being here. First of all, I know some of you may know, some of you may not know, but last night Tony had me give an announcement about Clint Meyer. He made it through surgery the other day really good, or yesterday. Everything went well, and he's doing good. And continue to pray for Clint and Yvonne. But everything come out really well. So praise God for that. Yeah. So, my name is Tim. Some of you may know me, some may not. But this morning, the message is from Nehemiah chapters 4 and 5. And what Nehemiah's, last week Tony talked about rebuilding the wall in Jerusalem. The wall was in despair, so to speak. Broken up, tore down. And they started rebuilding it last week. So that's where we're at today. We're in the rebuilding process and what goes on in that process. One thing before we start, there's three things I want you to think about. And just keep them in your back pocket or as we go along. Where we're at is we're in Jerusalem. And it's after Israel, or the Judeans have been carried off to Babylon. And it's after that 70-year captivity is where we're at. And we're actually in the third wave of return. The first wave was Zerubbabel. He come back and he built the temple. And he started about 538 B.C. before Christ and completed around 515 D.C. in about March. And then the second wave came Ezra. And he came back in about 458, around that time. And he brought the word, the scripture, back into Jerusalem. And then here we are at Nehemiah. He's on the third wave of return. And this is the time period at 445. So that's kind of where we're at. And as far as a place and a time is where we're at. Chapter 4 and 5. Nehemiah faces severe and violent opposition to his work of rebuilding the walls and gates of Jerusalem. We have seen this in the rebuilding and reconstruction pictures for us in the steps to recover from areas of damage of ruin in our own lives. As we have been following Nehemiah in this great project, we first saw his heartfelt concern and anguish over the damaged walls and the ruined gates of the capital city of his country, which was Jerusalem. It echoes the concern and the anguish that many of us may feel about areas that have been damaged in our own lives by sinful habits, wrong attitudes, feelings, bitterness, or resentment. Then we have seen Nehemiah's quick response to the opportunity to rebuild when it was given to him. This reflects our needs to respond to opportunities that may be given to us to recover. And I'm going to be reading out of Nehemiah chapter 4, 1 through 3, and it's on the screen also. But it so happened when Sanballat heard that we were rebuilding the wall, that he was furious and very indignant and mocked the Jews. And he spoke before his brethren and the army of Samaria and said, "What are those feeble Jews doing? Will they fortify themselves? Will they offer sacrifices? Will they complete it in a day? Will they revive the stones from the heaps of rubbish, stones that are burnt?" Now Tobiah the Ammonite was beside him, and he said, "Whatever they build, even a fox goes up on it, he will break down their stone wall." This kind of reflects effort in our part, in our own lives, together and recover from damage, hurt, ruin. Could be sickness, could be loss of a loved one, loss of property, could be a broken relationship. We'll experience opposition from the enemy. Almost invariably, his first attempt to halt such a recovery is to discourage us through ridicule, mockery, rejection, doubt, sadness. These are powerful weapons the enemy employs here. These were the guys that he had met before in chapter 2, and they were disturbed that Nehemiah had come for the well-being of the children of Israel. He told them, Nehemiah told them, they had no share, historic claim, or legal right in Jerusalem. That's what he told them the first meeting, and that was in Nehemiah 2:20. Ironically, them guys are still around. Sanballat, the governor of Samaria, and that is the area of Palestine, which we today call the West Bank. Tobiah, the representative of the country Ammon, which today is known as Jordan. In verse 7, we learn that the coalition includes the Arabs and the men from Ashdod. Today, Ashdod is part of the Gaza Strip. It is most interesting that history has repeated itself to this day. I was going to go with the group, and the COVID stopped it because you can't go travel to Israel. And we have a group that we was going with, and we were going to go to the Gaza Strip. They told us if we said Jesus there, we probably would die. So they're enemies. They're enemies of God. Is who they're enemies of. And that's these guys come along and try to stop the work of the wall. Now Nehemiah prays. Hear, O our God, for we are despised. Turn their reproach on their own heads and give them as plunder to a land of captivity. Do not cover their iniquity, and do not let their sin be blotted out from before you. For they have provoked you to anger before the builders. Now here at Nehemiah, you know, we've been taught to pray for your enemies, right? Pray for your enemies. Jesus said that. But he regards this attack as an insult against God himself. Note that he does not argue back, nor does he retaliate. He does not blister these men with angry rebuttal. He simply responds by praying. It reminds us of Peter's words about Jesus. And Peter said, when they hurled their insults at him, he did not retaliate. When he suffered, he made no threats. That's in 1 Peter 2:23. This is a helpful picture on how to handle that kind of attack. We're made to be like Jesus. We're made to grow to be like Jesus. Jesus told to pray for our enemies. That's what he told us. In the Old Testament, Proverbs 25:21 says, feed your enemies. In the New Testament, in Romans 12:20, it says, feed your enemies. Provoked you. That's what Nehemiah said. Provoked you. He is praying as a governor. The government's job is not mercy, but justice. Mercy is an individual matter, but in government, justice must prevail. That's why we have trouble in our own country right now. We have to have justice. The government has to have justice. And that's what Nehemiah is praying about. And he's in charge. He's the governor. So that's why his prayer was the way it was. Verse 6. So we built the wall, and the entire wall was joined together up to half its height, for the people had a mind to work. So I pulled several translations here. They're working on the wall. It's halfway done. When you're working for the Lord with the right mindset and with all your heart, the enemy will be angry and will conspire against you. In Mark 12:30, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind, and with all your strength. That's what they're loving God, and they're building this wall. God wants this wall built for their protection. And that's how they went about building as builders and during their work, with all their mind, enthusiasm, and all their heart. That's how they went about their work. That's how we need to go about our work for our Lord, with our mind and our heart. Nevertheless, we made our prayer to our God, and because of them, we set a watch against them day and night. So they just didn't set on a prayer. They prepared. They were ready to have set up a guard, because the enemy is looking to attack them. So they just didn't sit back on their prayer, but they prepared. In Proverbs 4:23, above all else, guard your heart. Amen. Keep your heart with all diligence, for out of it spring the issues of life. Now, how do you guard your heart? You got to guard your heart. And here's some things how I guard my heart. Study my Bible, time in prayer, choosing good friends, overcome temptation, have an accountability partner, overcome doubt, and surround yourself with, like we're doing today. This helps guard our hearts. Today is what we're doing right now. Then Judah said, the strength of the laborers is failing, and there is so much rubbish that we're not able to build the wall. This is understandable. There is so much rubbish from all the brokenness. Could be from a relationship. It could be from anger. It could be from pain. They're not building a new wall. They don't have new material. They're building the wall out of brokenness. And that's what they're building the wall out. And it's just, they're wearing down. And like a couple weeks ago or 3 weeks ago, we went out and helped Sam. His barn burnt. It was just all dirty and crummy and just a pile of rubble is what it was when we got there. But he's going to bring something back up out of that. A job I worked at about 25 years ago or 20 years ago, the place burnt down. It was manufacturing. We had to go in there and get our machine tools, our tools, and everything. And at the end of the, after 5 minutes, you just, remember, this stuff burnt. It's burnt. It just come out and you get wore down from all this, the brokenness. It just gets you down. 11 through 12. And our adversary said, they will neither know or see anything until we come into their midst and kill them and cause the work to cease. So it was when the Jews who dwelt near them came, and that they told us 10 times, from whatever place you turn, they will be upon us. The enemy will take advantage of that weakness and discouragement. When you're doing the right thing, sometimes it'll wear you down. You will be attacked. It might be a loss of your job. It may be a loss of relationship when you're doing the right thing. I can only imagine being a servant in Washington trying to do the right thing right now and get scorned. I can only imagine that. That's how the enemy works, and it will discourage you. And when you're trying to lift yourself up and God's building you up, the enemy's going to attack when you start wearing down. I'm going to read 13 also. I didn't put it on the screen. Therefore, I positioned men behind the lower gates of the wall at the openings, and I set the people according to their families with their swords, their spears, and their bows. And I looked and I arose and said to nobles and to the leaders and to the rest of the people, do not be afraid of them. Remember the Lord great and awesome, and fight for your brethren, your sons, your daughters, your wives, and your houses. And it happened, when our enemies heard that it was known to us and that God had brought their plot to nothing, that all of us returned to the wall, everyone returned to his work. Nehemiah's response to their attacks that they had planned was deliberate, enlightening, and helpful. First, he carefully looked over the situation. We have to carefully look it over, the attack coming at us. He carefully assesses it and evaluates what's needed. This approach is necessary if we're going to improve in our own lives. Because no one's arrived. We're still being built. We come from brokenness, all of us. And we're still being built up. And the enemy will attack that. I don't care if you're three quarters, halfway, he's going to attack. We must observe exactly where we're under attack. What are we addicted to? A wrong habit, a drug, an attitude of mind perhaps, bitterness of spirit possibly. When we have identified the source of attack, we must post a guard at that point. This is what Nehemiah does. He assesses the situation and prepares for a full assault. Then, secondly, Nehemiah reviews the spiritual resources available to him. Because they were believers, they had a power at work in their lives the enemies knew nothing about. You have a power in you if you're a believer, and you have the Holy Spirit in you, and they don't know nothing about the Holy Spirit. They don't know him. They had invisible resources that could count on in times of danger. The great and awesome God who was with them would stand with them in their peril. When they remembered this, they became reassured and renewed in courage. It is good to have a strategy, but faith is more important. But today we're coming together, and as we get together, we get courage when we get together. And we got to be in the Spirit to get our courage to keep going. Ephesians 6:10, above all, taking the shield of faith with which you will be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked one. Above all, faith. It's good to have a strategy. It's very good. One thing to keep in mind, no matter how good my strategy, it is not what made them fail. God frustrated their plan is what made them fail. So it was from that time on that half my servants worked at construction, while the other half held the spears, the shields, the bows, and wore armor. And the leaders were behind all the house of Judah, those who built on the wall and those who carried burdens, loaded themselves so that with one hand they worked on construction and with the other hand held a weapon. Every one of the builders had his sword girded at his side as he built, as the one who sounded the trumpet was beside me. I got a little ahead of myself there. But anyhow, when we go out into the world and we're building, we need to carry our sword, whether it be in our heart, whether it be in our pocket, wherever it is, keep it with you. But he combines the work with the war. Each man goes to work with an instrument in one hand and a sword in the other for battle. Thus, he is ready for either. Charles Spurgeon, the great English preacher of the last century published a newspaper in his church called The Sword and the Trowel. The name was clearly derived from Nehemiah. Spurgeon said that Christians would always be building the kingdom of God, but be ready for battle at any time. Verses 19 through 20 further illustrate this wonderful blending of faith and preparation. Then I said to the nobles, the rulers, and the rest of the people, the work is great and extensive, and we are separated far from one another on the wall. Wherever you hear the sound of the trumpet, rally to us there. Our God will fight for us. There's two things in here that really caught my attention. One was, wherever you hear the sound of the trumpet, it says, rally to us there. My mindset from as an early Christian was the sound of the trumpet, the rapture. And I'm always thinking, when, when. Now I've changed my mindset. Where? I'm not worried about when. Jesus said, I got that. God's got that. The Father knows. I don't have to worry about when. I need to be the where. Wherever the trumpet sounds. And we know where that's going to be. It's going to be in the heavens. Wherever the trumpet sounds, rally to us there. The other one was, God will fight for you. And a lot of you all know me, and some of you don't know. 4 years ago, I had a tumor the size of a football in me. It was benign. But with that, hallelujah, and a lot of prayer and the mighty hand of God. But anyhow, there's a lot that goes with that when you've got, if you got COVID, there's a lot going on with that. But there's a lot to go on with all that. Doctor visits, they got to check up, they got to do this, they got to do CAT scans, all this stuff. I do not like going to the doctor and waiting. I do not like to be poked by needles. And I, at the time, I took a vow to read through the whole Bible. But anyhow, I get in the middle of all this, I get to Exodus 14:14, and I stopped right there. And it says, your God will fight for you. You can count on that. You can count on God fighting for you. So every time I go to the hospital and I get out of the car, I get out and I follow Jesus in there. And I never had to wait for a CAT scan, never had to wait for an appointment. I went to get water drawn out of my lungs. And my wife says, they're putting needles this long in you. I said, yeah. I was following Jesus. I had to learn to follow Jesus and let God fight for me. I didn't get anxious. It just took care of it. My last appointment, I still have to go back and get checked. But in that interim, 6 months after surgery, I had to go back to get another CAT scan. I was running a little tight that day. I got there 15 minutes. My appointment was 2:00. I run a little tight. I got there at 1:45. I like to leave a little time for a tire change if I need it. I get there at 1:45 and I get in there. At 2:05, 10 minutes later, I'm back in the truck going home. I thought, just have to follow Jesus. He got it. But God, in our hardest times, will fight for us. He fights for us every day. Even in our little times, He's fighting for us. Chapter 5. So now Nehemiah has been dealing with oppression, but now he's got to deal with oppression from internal, from the inside. It was coming from the outside. Now it's coming from the inside. And there was a great outcry of the people and their wives against their Jewish brethren. For there were those who said, we are sons and our daughters are many. Therefore, let us get grain that we may eat and live. There were also some who said, we have mortgaged our lands and our vineyards and houses that we might buy grain because of the famine. There were also Those who said, "We have borrowed money for the king's tax on our lands and vineyards. Yet now our flesh is as the flesh of our brethren, our children as their children. And indeed we are forcing our sons and our daughters to be slaves. And some of our daughters have been brought into slavery. It is not our power to redeem them, for other men have our lands and vineyards." So now we have internal strife. They're trying to rebuild, and now internal strife has come in. You may experience that too. In your struggle to recover some area of your life, you may run into family problems, pressures, and problems with those who work with you. Perhaps even from other brothers and sisters in the Lord. In this case, it was a clash between the workers and the officials, the laborers and the overseers who were working on this project. This is a class struggle. One's with, one's without. It's typical of all class struggles. While they were working on the walls day and night, they had no time to plant crops. Yet they had to eat. Verse 3 reveals that it made it difficult, the famine. So with all this wall building going on, with all these enemies attacking them, and they're going on and there's a famine in the land to go along with that. And they're having to deal with that. So in those times, if you could not pay your taxes or debts, you sold your children or your wife to be slaves, at last of all yourself, of course, in order to pay what you owed. This had already happened to some. These were brothers and sisters. Nehemiah could not change the conditions. He can't change the famine, but he could bring out the problems and change them. When I heard their complaints, I was very angry. After thinking it over, I spoke out against these nobles and officials, and I told them, "You are hurting your own relatives by charging interest when they borrow money." Then I called a public meeting to deal with the problem. At the meeting, I said to them, "We are doing all we can to redeem our Jewish relatives who have been had to sell themselves to pagan foreigners. But you're selling them back into slavery again. How often must we redeem them?" And they had nothing to say for their defense. And I'm using the NLT right here, but it's most translations says usury. In fact, one I was reading from says usury. That's charging interest is what that is. It's common practice in our day. We borrow money from the bank or from each other, however that works. The Jews were allowed to do this. They were allowed to charge interest to other nations. But one thing was prohibited. Moses spoke directly to this issue in Deuteronomy 23, verses 19 and 20. He said that when a Jew lent money to another Jew, he was not to charge any interest. These people are just trying to eat and pay their debts. They're not looking for the $300,000 mansion somewhere. They're just trying to survive. He was to loan the money, but he was loaning it to a brother. There would be no interest. In some translations, it said that the interest rate was like 1% a month, which don't seem like a bunch, but that's 12% a year. But if you're in a famine, and that's a lot of money back then, that's a lot. It'll take you out. Let's say right now, that's 12% a year. Let's say this to give us a little bit in our mind. What if they changed the housing rates tomorrow and said, "We don't care if you got a fixed rate or not, your interest rate is 12% now." Our economy would wreck, is what would happen. It would wreck it. There'd be a housing crisis. We'd be in a wreck. And that's what was going on here. And they were doing something that they weren't supposed to be doing because they'd been commanded by Moses. They're the children of Israel not to do this. Then I pressed further. And also, it gave them a bad witness to the other nations. They're selling their own people to do this. Then I pressed further. What you're doing is not right. Should you not walk in the fear of our God in order to avoid being mocked by enemy nations? I myself, as well as my brothers and my workers, have been lending people money and grain. But now let us stop this business of charging interest. You must restore their fields, their vineyards, olive groves, and homes to them this very day, and repay the interest you charged when you lent them money, grain, new wine, and olive oil. So what this does is, the rest of the chapter details the final action, Nehemiah, to overcome this internal strife. These weren't the enemies. These were their brothers and sisters that was causing the strife. He first uncovered the real cause. He shows it is simple greed. That's the problem. He confronts the overseers with it, rebuking them and showing them it is wrong. He gains their promise, always by God's help, to stop this practice. There is a place and time for forthright, blunt confrontation in our relationships with others. Sometimes we need to point out to people that what they're doing is wrong and help them see what needs to be done. This is what Nehemiah does. And then he does one final thing. They replied, "We will give everything and demand nothing more from the people. We will do as you say." Then I called the priest and made the nobles and the officials swear to what they had promised. I shook the folds of my robe and said, "If you fail to keep your promise, may God shake you like this from your homes and from your property." The whole assembly responded, "Amen," and they praised the Lord. And the people did as they were as promised. So what he did was they responded. They had a confrontation. It was direct. And you know what? They changed. And they kept it moving. That's what happened there. Just give me a second. The example of Nehemiah. Now, last night I told Joe and Tony, I said, we're going to talk about a little bit of politics here. They said, go ahead. So here we go. "Moreover, from the time that I was appointed to be their governor in the land of Judah, from the 20th year until the 32nd year of King Artaxerxes, 12 years, neither I nor my brothers ate the governor's provisions." You know where the governor's provisions come from? They come from the people, from tax. What that governor in Missouri's got down there where he lives, it come from the people. That's where it come from. But the former governors who were before me laid burdens on the people and took from them bread and wine, besides 40 shekels of silver. Yes, even their servants bore rule over the people, but I did not do so because of the fear of God. Indeed, I also continued the work on this wall. And we did not buy any land. All my servants were gathered there for the work. They went to serve. They were serving the people. He was the governor. And he didn't go, he could have bought land. He could have built himself up, but he didn't. He was a public servant. And that's he feared God. They feared God. They didn't have road to nowheres. They didn't have no pork. They didn't have nothing in their government. It was straight out. They were there to serve God. And so right now, sometimes we look at our government right now, and I know some of us shake our heads. And like, I get mad. I get mad. And I decided I can't get mad. That's not going to help. I need to pray for them. I got to pray for my leaders. And we're being burdened. So I'm going to read something to you this morning. America, America, come to me, all of you who are burdened and stressed, and I'll give you my rest. In times such as these, be a faithful, not fearful generation. Seek first my heavenly kingdom, and I will heal your land and provide you with a peace that surpasses all human understanding. You are in the world, but not of the world. Trust me, be obedient, and abide in my word. Be anxious for nothing, and remember, I am in control. I will never leave you or forsake you. Stand firm and keep on the full armor of God. Be still, all is well. Amen and amen. I had my bookmarker, and I'm like, I need to hear that this morning. I'm going to pray about it. I'm going to let God fight for it. I'm going to voice my opinion or my voice to Him, but I'm going to let God lead me in that. And then Nehemiah has a prayer here at the last verse of this chapter. Remember me, my God, for good according to all that I've done for this people. Now at the onset of that, it looks like he is self-serving and bargaining with God. That's what it looks like, doesn't it? God is not unjust. He will not forget your work and the love you have shown Him as you have helped His people and continue to help them. That's in Hebrews 6:10. You can count on that. What Nehemiah is really praying is, Lord, I sought to do your will. Now respond according to your gracious nature. He does not demand anything, nor does he ask for anything specifically. He does not bargain with God. He is merely calling God upon God to honor his promise. This is what we often do in prayer. There are two major lessons that will come forth from these chapters. First, I call it PPP. When we face the enemy, we should do so with careful preparation, perseverance, and above all, prayer. But when we face discord and internal strife, let us do it with justice, with honest confrontation, and by setting a good example ourselves. As we do this, God will enable us to solve the problems that face us and move toward rebuilding the ruined areas of our lives. We're not done yet, but I've got a little prayer here. Our Father, strengthen us to act like Nehemiah of old and stand against the pressures of our day. Help us to be men and women who visibly live according to what we profess. We ask in Jesus' name, amen. Okay, now back to what we put in our back pocket or back of our head here. Back to the temple, the word, and the rebuild. Temple. In Ezra 3:8, God's house. They built temple. That's where God lived. God's house. It says it, God's house. Where's the temple at now? Right there, exactly. That's where the temple is, God's house. That's where he resides. Worshiping. Ezra brought back the word. And worshiping, we have worship up here. You know what these guys are singing a lot of time? Most of the time, probably 99.99999, is the word. They're singing from the Word. Them songs come from the Word of God. So worship can be praising in music like we do. And we're very fortunate, blessed here. Readings from scriptures could be prayers, could be a sermon. And then we have the walls. Walls can be good or bad. I remember Reagan back when in the 80s, I'm dating myself a little bit, but not bad. He said, Gorbachev tore this wall down. And the wall was keeping people in, not letting them get out. I prayed many times. God knocked down these walls. The walls were keeping drug addictions and break down them walls. Break down them walls. Walls can be bad. But walls can be good. Protection for social, civil. And also God builds a wall around us if you're a believer. You got angels surrounding. You got a wall. You got each other. God is building a wall around you for your protection, to help in your salvation. And this is what we're rebuilding our walls. We're building our walls up. So we all started out at rubble. And God is still building all of us. It all starts in believing in Jesus Christ. They went back and built the temple first. And having Jesus in your heart. Once you have Jesus in your heart, you can start worshiping the God. And once you do that, you start getting, you have protect. You're in a circle, in God's circle. You have a wall, and you're being, and you're building up. God is building you up. And for unbelievers, it's not hard. And I don't know if there's any unbelievers in this room or not. There may be some on this camera that we're filming. And I'm reading from Romans 9, or 10, 9. 9 and 10. It's not complicated. If you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For it is by believing in your heart that you are made right with God. And it is by confessing with your mouth that you are saved. It's a belief in the heart. It saves you. And confessing Him as Lord, Lord and Savior. First, you got to realize you need a Savior. You got to realize where you're at. You're without a Savior, but He has already done the work for you. But you got to realize you need Jesus because of your sin. 10:13 says, for everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Everyone, whoever calls on the Lord will be saved if they believe in their heart, with their heart. For the believers, in Nehemiah 2:20, he told the enemies, they have no share, historic claim, or legal right in Jerusalem. They got no place there. The enemy has no place in you. You got to go. Get out. When he's opposing, we all have problems. We're trying to build back. Enemy's got no place. Out. You got Jesus in there. They cannot commune together. Sorry. You got to go. The enemy wants to keep the work of the Lord in your life from happening. He wants to wreck it. If you got Jesus, there's no share, claim, or right in your heart and mind for the deceiver. I'm going to finish with this. Do you know what Nehemiah means? It means Jehovah comforts. Jesus said, I will send the comforter. That's what his name meant. He's over there building a wall. So let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we give you thanks, Father, for your word today, Father. Father, we give you thanks for Jesus Christ, who would come into a broken world and would come and lay his life down for us, Father. Father, we pray for those who do not know Jesus. We pray for the lost. And Father, we pray that if the that the lost would just come to Jesus and proclaim him as their Lord and Savior. That, Lord, they, whoever's listening today has learned that Jesus has done the hard work, and there's no works about it. It's the work of Jesus Christ. They're just believe in the heart and be saved, Lord. And if they don't know Jesus, that they would see the need for Jesus and confess their sins to you, Lord. Lord, be with all of us as we go through this week and we go through this world that we're in, but not of, Lord. Protect us and be over us as we go. And we give you the honor and praise and all the glory. In the name of Jesus, amen. Thank you, guys.